dear colleagues, it's my pleasure to welcome you to our institution, Belgrade Banking Academy, Faculty of Finance, Banking and Insurance, was founded 10 years ago. During this period, we put effort to reach the high standard in higher education and research area. For this relatively short period of time, we have managed to become the best private faculty in the field of social science and in our country. This workshop, Understanding the Economic Development of Eastern Europe, organized by Weast Initiative and BBA, is one of the five important scientific events from this program devoted to the 10th anniversary of Belgrade Banking Academy. During these two conference days, 18 working papers will be presented concerning different aspects of economic development. Presenters come from 14 countries such as England, Denmark, Germany, Bulgaria, Russia, United States, France, Croatia, Sweden, Slovenia, Poland, Hungary, and Serbia. Besides, there are more than 15 participants from these and other countries. Topics that will be presented at this conference are especially important due to economic problems which Eastern European countries are facing during the last 5 to 7 years. I do hope that outcomes of this workshop will be helpful for creating economic policy in all Eastern European countries and help them to find better solutions for current economic problems such as low economic growth, high public debt, high budget deficit, high unemployment rates, and others. At the end, I express special thanks to Stephen Broadberry, our former student, who is now a PhD student at York University, for his huge contribution in organizing this workshop. I wish you a fruitful conference and pleasant stay at BBA and in Belgrade. Thank you. Professor Stephen Broadberry, playing yours. Thank you.
my pleasure to introduce Stephen Broadberry, who is a professor at the London School of Economics in Economic History. I'm going to make it very brief and just want to say shortly that Steve has influenced the economic history professionals two ways. One is through his research, which I deeply admire, and one is through his work on trying to get more people into economic history, one of which I am. And I hope Steve will continue doing that and that the rest of you will continue doing that in the future so that economic history can survive. Steve, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Now, you'll see that the title of this lecture is Accounting for the Great Divergence. And I'm going to be using the word accounting in two senses. One is a very straightforward use of the term accounting, putting some numbers out, giving you a set of numbers to describe developments. But I don't want to use it there. That's going to be drawing on work in historical management accounting, which I've been heavily involved in over the last 15 years or so. The second sense we use in which we use the word accounting is if I tell you I'm going to give an account of something, I'm going to explain it, how did it happen. So we want to cover both aspects, and the talk will be split into two parts, really. The first part is going to provide an overview of the great divergence using the historical national accounting framework. And just so you know where we're going, what I'm going to argue here is that the revisionist work of people like Ken Pomeranz, Rosanna Carter-Sorati, Wilbur Frank, and so on, went a bit too far. They were trying to claim that the richest parts of Asia were just as developed as the richest parts of Europe as late as 1800, so that the Great Divergence only starts in 1800. I don't think that's correct, and I'm going to show you numbers which will demonstrate that. However, that doesn't mean that the debate hasn't been fruitful. I think, on the contrary, it has been extremely fruitful. It's made us worry a lot about regional variation, not just within Asia, but also within Europe. When I move on to the second part of the talk, on the explanation, I'm going to suggest it's very helpful for us to use that regional variation to understand the Great Divergence. In particular, we'll be seeing that what really matters for the Great Divergence is the emergence of the North Sea area economies of Europe, particularly Britain and Holland. They diverge not just from the rest of Europe, but also from the rest of Asia. But there's also regional variation within Asia. And so one of the things we'll begin to see is that there are some similarities between the most successful parts of Europe that have the Industrial Revolution, particularly Britain, and the most successful parts of Asia, which go on to have the first transition to modern high growth in Asia, in particular Japan. So within this framework, we start to look for some similarities between European and Asian economies, not just differences. Okay, so let me start then. The first half of the talk will be about measurement, that simple use of the term accounting. And I want to suggest that we can now use historical national accounts to track the Great Divergence. We even have historical national accounts for some countries on an annual basis that reach back to about 1300. And I must emphasize that these are drawn from and build on data that was collected at the time. It's a development of the work of Angus Maddison. Now, a lot of people are very critical of Maddison. For me, he was a great inspiration. And a great friend. And I see my work as building on what Angus did. Angus, by being the first person to put all the numbers together and give us a picture of global development, I think made a fantastic step forward. But for the pre-1820 period, a lot of his estimates, they're not very frequent. There's an observation for the year 1000, then 1500, then 1600, just a few years. And a lot of them he would have admitted are conjectures. They're not really based directly on estimating an annual series of GDP for each country. So here's a picture of the development of the economies which I'm going to be examining today, according to Angus Madison. You can see the sense in which there's a lot of conjecture early on, around about the year 1000. Angus was working in 1919 international dollars, and that's the currency I'm going to be using also. The lowest you can expect to see is about 400, and most economies are very close to 400. Bare bones existence is 499 dollars. Bear in mind that in 1990, people viewed a dollar a day as living in poverty. So if everybody lived in poverty, it would be 365. 1990 international dollars would be your GDP per capita. So the UK in 1000 is pretty much a bare bones existence. It's just a small elite who are fabulously rich, but they don't pull up the average by very much. Now, I don't think we need to do that. We don't need to just make conjectures. In fact, medieval and early modern Europe and Asia were more literate and more numerous than people think. They left accounts in which it's not surprising, perhaps, that people wanted to know, were they making money on things, so they wrote down and established accounts. It's not just government accounts on tax revenue and how they spent it, but also lots of private institutions also kept accounts. Hospitals, educational establishments, religious institutions. A lot of the information is scattered in archives, requires work to pull it together. That's the difference. From the mid-19th century, governments put it all together for you. Before the mid-19th century, they don't. You have to go and collect it and pull it together. You need to cross-check things, put it in a historical national accounting framework, and then we can build up a realistic picture of what happened. The picture that emerges here, I think, is one in which we see these reversals of fortune, not just in Europe, but also in Asia, and then between the two continents as well. Let me start with Europe's little divergence then. I'm going to be drawing here on these four series. I was involved in reconstructing English national income back to 1270. We have a Dutch project which occurred at the same time with the same funding body led by Jan Houten van Zanden. Paolo Malanema working on Italy, and Leandro Plasas, Guzura, and Carlos Alvaro on Spain. I'm going to continue presenting the data in 1919 international dollars because I think it is convenient. And here's what we see for those four European countries. An interesting thing is that before the bad debt, the bad debt spikes in 1348. You'll notice here that England and Holland are poorer, about 1819 dollars, that's about twice their bonus existence. Italy and Spain rather higher. So Mediterranean Europe has higher per capita GDP than the North Sea area. If we look at the period around about 1800, it's the other way around. Here's Great Britain, here's the Netherlands, they are richer than and Spain. How does this divergence occur? think there are two turning points. The first turning point is surely the Black Death. After the Black Death, then GDP per capita increases in England and in Holland. You'll notice it also increases in Italy initially, but then declines. So what's distinctive about Britain and Holland, and this is important, I keep referring back to this, is that the gains of the Black Death period are sustained. They never go back down. The positive growth does not disappear. Spain, on the other hand, does not have an increase after the Black Death. No capital GDP actually declines. We're going to need to be able to explain that. Why do we get these different responses to the same shock of a Black Death? The second turning point is around about 1500. Around about 1500, you see Holland has caught up with Italy. And thereafter, you have the Dutch Golden Age, here in particularly well, but about 1570 and 1650, the Dutch Golden Age is really tremendous. As we see, there's like paintings in museums and so on. Also, a lot of money around in Holland. After about 1650, then, there's a surge in growth in Britain, which leads on to the Industrial Revolution. Now, what I've given you is a table with some benchmarks. It's easier to see what's going on there, but I want to conclude this section by showing you the annual data. What it reminds us, I think, is that pre-modern growth is a series of ups and downs. And what you really need to get to modern economic growth is to dampen the growth reversals. That does not happen here for Italy and Spain in this period through to 1870. So Spain is the orange line. Here's Spain. You have ups and downs, but no trend. Same with Italy. Up, down, up, down, but no trend. What matters for getting to modern economic growth is in the British and Dutch cases, the increase across the Black Death is sustained. Then the Dutch have their golden age. Then the British have this run up to the Industrial Revolution. So getting to modern economic growth is about avoiding reversals or dampening. Where does Eastern Europe fit in, you might be asking. I found myself asking a couple of days ago, so I struggled because we don't have reliable estimates for Eastern Europe of GDP per capita for the medieval or early modern periods. I have to slightly modify that after breakfast this morning, where I was introduced new Polish estimates, which are available, which you are going to see later. Fortunately, I think they're broadly consistent with what I'm about to say, because I didn't have the benefit of those numbers when I prepared this slide. What I noted was that for the period 1870 to 1913, we have data on real wages, and we have data on GDP per capita, and they seem to be consistent with each other. So what I did was to go back to the paper Christian Gupta from the Economic Review 2006, where we analysed real wages in Europe and in Asia. And within Europe, we identified three regions: the northwest, which is dominated by Britain and the Netherlands, and the south, which is dominated by Italy and Spain, and then central and eastern Europe, which is dominated by Poland and Germany. So here are the data from that table. What we found was that in Eastern Europe, nominal wages measured in terms of silver and prices, measured in terms of silver, tended to be lower in Eastern Europe than in the rest of Europe. Lower even than in Southern Europe. But nevertheless, divided the wage by the price and looked at the real wage, they seem to be quite similar in Southern Europe and in Eastern Europe. And they follow very much the same pattern. And we see here the divergence between the North Sea area and the rest of Europe. So I think Eastern Europe fits into that pattern. And it confirms what I said a moment ago about avoiding growth reversals. The North Sea area, those economies hung on to the gains of the post-Mad Death era. Southern Europe did not. Real wages declined after 1500 in Southern Europe. And they also declined in Eastern Europe. So I think Eastern Europe then does fit in to the divergence pattern I've shown you. It's the North Sea area that's different, and the rest of Europe that lags behind and loses the gains of the post-Mad Death era. Now, given the existence of the data on the real wages for parts of Eastern Europe and also urbanisation rates, then I wrote this slide saying it would be relatively simple to produce GDP per capita estimates for some parts of Eastern Europe. And we've then urged people to do it. They've already done it. So you will see on Sunday some estimates for Poland by Mikolaj Krawczyk. But I think more needs to be done. And there are various ways of constructing GDP. Various levels of sophistication. So I would encourage more work in this area. If anybody's interested in that, do please talk to me after the lecture. What's the picture for Eastern Europe, sorry, for Europe as a whole? The rise of the North Sea area. Within Asia, we're going to see a similar reversal of fortunes between Japan and China. The data I'm drawing on here, I'm involved in reconstructing these estimates for Japan, China, and India. The Indian estimates will be published in Explorations in Economic History later this year. The Chinese and Japanese estimates have just about settled down, but we haven't yet sent them to journals. Here's the basic picture of what happens in the key Asian markets for which we have data. First thing to note is China was the GDP per capita leader at the start of the second millennium. This is the Northern Song Dynasty, around about 1200 to 1200 is the norm here. There's a little boom between 1020 and 1050, which gets up to about 1500 1990 international dollars. Notice that's about the same level as Italy in the medieval period. After that, it's a sort of general decline. It's not very much decline in the Ming Dynasty, but it really falls away in the Qing period. Japan, on the other hand, is moving in the opposite direction. And starts off quite poor, 590 international dollars, until there's a boost to growth between 1450 and 1600. Then a plateau again until about 1730, it actually turns up again, and that leads on to a burst of growth following the Meiji Restoration in 1868, which gives us modern economic growth. So Japan overtakes China in the 18th century. If we look at the Indian case, India did start in around 1600. It's declining along with China. Japan catches up with India in the 17th century, and pulls ahead only in the 18th century. So we're seeing the reversal of fortunes and the emergence of Japan as the Asian per capita leader in the 18th century. One thing we have to worry about here is regional variation. I know many of you will be aware that Pomerantz is making the claim that it's the Yangtze Delta that was relatively rich part of China in 1800. Maybe the Yangtze Delta was still as rich as Japan until the 19th century. And we can quantify that. There's a paper by Bojong-Li and comparing the Yangtze Delta with the Netherlands. In the 1820s, the Yangtze Delta is about half the level of GDP per capita in the Netherlands. That gives us a GDP per capita figure of around about 1,000 1990 international dollars for the Yangtze Delta region. That's a little bit higher than Japan. So, we have to worry about regional variation as well. And I now want to put the two sides together and see how the great divergence emerges from the interaction between the two little divergences that I've shown you within Europe and Asia. So, the world leader in the start of the second millennium is China. China in 1086, when we can make a comparison with England, China's ahead. We have to be a bit careful here though, because we've already seen in the 11th century, England is a relatively poor part of Europe. Well, the richest part of Europe is Italy. Well, we can't measure that until around about 1300. But around about 1300, it seems clear Italy's about 1500, 1990 international dollars. It's got to be richer than China. There's a bit of a gap here for the modern interlude, but it looks as if it will be 1,900,000. Nevertheless, we can't say for sure that the great divergence has occurred here yet, because we know in the 19th century the richer parts of China were 50% richer than the average of China. And that would put them on par with Italy. However, what we can say is that even allowing for that scale of regional variation, the great divergence has got to be underway before 1800, somewhere before 1500 and 1800. If you were to look at 1600, for example, Holland at 2372 is an awfully long way ahead of China at 977. Even if we allow a 50% premium here in the Yangtze Delta, so that's 1500, Holland's a long way ahead. But some people might be saying, Holland's very small. We're talking about, there's only one province of the Netherlands. So perhaps we can't still say the great divergence is definitely on the way. But by the time we get to, say, 1700, England is sort of twice the Chinese level. So by then, I think it's very clear that the great divergence is underway. And furthermore, this is now accepted by Ken Pomerantz. Pomerantz, in a conference on the great divergence 10 years after, in 2011, said he thought it was wrong to say the richest parts of Asia were on par with the richest parts of Europe in 1800. He would now settle for 1700. That seems to me to be broadly consistent with the data I'm showing you here. So I think we can now say we have kind of converged on some sort of agreement between the California schools and the historical national accounting. And I think we can see the relationship between the little divergences and the great divergence. We've got to start thinking about similarities between parts of Europe and parts of Asia, as well as differences. So China and India are kind of following the same sort of trajectory as Italy and Spain. this is sort of stagnation decline. You have growth. They're not trending up. Japan, on the other hand, is looking a bit like Britain. A period of growth, a plateau, more growth, plateau, and so on. So you're hanging on to the gains. Why does the rate divergence occur then? It's because although Japan is following the same trajectory and pulling up the Asian frontier, it's from starting from a lower level. Japan is growing more slowly than Britain, and it therefore does not achieve the transition to modern economic growth until somewhat later, after the Meiji Restoration. And so the two continents are then diverging whilst the reversals of fortune are taking place in the two continents. So that's what I wanted to say about the measurement side. We can now, I think, account for the great divergence in that narrow use of the word accounting. You can say when it occurred, where it occurred, but doesn't yet tell us why. Why did it happen? If we want to fully account for the great divergence, then we need a sort of narrative. How did this come about? And I want to say that this part of the talk is going to be more speculative because there's been much less work done in so far. And I've partly written this to sort of stimulate people to go and do more, particularly on measuring the kind of explanatory variables. I'll show you some measures, but they are a little bit rudimentary at this point. What I want to do is to say, for me, the explanation of the divergence, in fact, the little divergences and the great divergence, comes from understanding big shocks hit the world economy, and they have different effects on different economies because of some underlying structures, structural differences between those economies. The two shocks which I'm going to emphasize, I've already prefigured in the way I presented the data. Remember I said there are two turning points, around about 1348 and around about 1500. 1348 is the Black Death. We need to understand why does this affect some economies positively, but only temporarily, and the North Sea area is the one that forges ahead and hangs on to the events. It starts in Western China, moves into Europe through trade, reaches England in 1348. That's the first shock. There's differential effects. Second shock is the new trade routes opening up around 1500. The voyages of discovery, Europeans can no longer trade across the Middle East through to the Silk Road. They find new routes going around South Africa, and then they find routes sailing west when they run into the Americas. I think these shocks had asymmetric effects. And that's just because of these different underlying factors. And I'm going to stress three factors. First one is the sort of underlying central structure. I'm going to be emphasizing the need for diversification of your economy. We'll be interested in the structure within agriculture. Actually, one of the things we'll see is the North Sea area looks a bit different in the breakdown between the livestock sector versus arable farming. But secondly, also movement of labour away from agriculture into industry and services. Getting into a situation where people are prepared to leave the land. Second thing is institutions. Here I'm going to point to a bit of a tension in the literature between those who think the state was too strong in the medieval period and needed to be weakened, the sort of Ashenoglu, Constable Robinson, executive constraints argument, but there are others who say no, the problem was the state was too weak, it needed to be expanded and creating unified market. Stephen Epstein in particular. Thirdly, I want to look at what I've grouped together as the quantity and quality of labour. You'll be more familiar with the terms from the Industrious Revolution, or in Protestant ethic from an earlier literature, and human capital. But let me expand on all those three main areas, the underlying sectoral differences, and then I'll talk you through how the shocks had the differential effects. The thing to bear in mind on the sectoral diversification is that pre-modern growth typically follows a pattern of terms of trade boom in a stable market. Wool would be a good example. There's a surge in demand, the price goes up, supply more. Eventually, it goes into reverse. Terms of trade are bad, actually. And in lots of pre-modern economies, any growth you had in the boom phase disappears. You remember when I showed you those graphs? Growth looks a lot like that in the pre-modern era. Boom, growth reversal. So what you want to do then to hang on to the gains is to specialise and diversify. And that will then dampen the growth reversal. Your economy is not totally driven, totally dependent on the one booming sector, and maybe something else can then boom later on. Now, how do we see differences within Europe? The first one is within agriculture, the North Sea area. Was more animal-oriented than the rest of Europe or Asia relatively early on. Let me show you here a table for the share of the livestock sector in English agricultural value added. After the Black Death, you see that gets up to something like 60%. That's a phenomenally high level. If you look at India in the 20th century, we might see 20%. There's a certain relative price effects there, we'll talk about on that. The other thing we can see is movement from people working in agriculture to specialising and working in industry and services. And again, there's quite a difference between the North Sea area here. Most of these numbers come from Bob Allen's paper in the European Review 2000. But the English numbers from the project that I was involved in. By 1600, the Dutch are relying on imports of grain, which they pay for by exporting higher value-added products. By 1700, the share of the labour force in agriculture is even smaller in England. And England is remaining self-sufficient in grain until we get to the 19th century. The agricultural share of the labour force is substantially higher in the other European countries here and also in Asia. So, sectoral diversification matters if you want to hang on to growth, dampen growth reversals. Second thing that seems to matter is institutions. As I've already mentioned, there's a bit of a split in the literature between people like Ashmore and Johnson Robinson emphasising executive constraints, people like Epstein emphasising the need to build up state capacity. So dealing with the Ashmore, Johnson and Robinson argument first then, they argue that the reason that British and Dutch are successful after 1500 is that the constraints imposed by the merchants on rulers through parliament and so on are sufficient to stop the state acting arbitrarily. In Spain and Portugal, on the other hand, merchants are too weak, they can't do that, and so we get this divergence within Europe. The Epstein and O'Brien argument seems on the face of it to be the opposite. So, however, it's not the problem. The problem is not that the states are too strong, they need to be weakened and constrained, it's that medieval states are too weak. Their power is fragmented. The ruler seems like a strong figure, but he's actually very dependent people throughout the kingdom, looking at it from Marbley's tomb, and so then you don't have a unified market. And what you need for growth is to centralize the state power, expand state capacity, rather than imposing constraints on the executive. And notice here, there can be a link to diversification. It's not just about creating a unified market. We're also concerned that people feel confident enough to leave the land. If there's a boom, and you can make more money in industry, you want to stay in industry, specialise, and you can make even more money. But do you dare to do that if you know when the slump comes, you haven't got any food, because you've given up. You want a system of borrowing, but you need a state strong enough to bring that about. That's an argument of Peter Solo from a long time ago in the Economic History Review. So, should we really take this split between literature at full face value? I think we can say we need both. And this is very much the argument of Mark Duchenko in his recent book on European states. He argues, on the basis of European experience between 1500 and 1913, that you needed a regime that was both fiscally centralised and politically limited. And there's a lot of data around. It seems to me to back that up. We can show that early modern Britain and Holland dominated Spain and Portugal in terms of both the ability to raise taxes, that allows expansion of state capacity, but also in the control exercised by merchant interests over the state through Parliament. So here we have from Caravan and Hanic, per capita fiscal revenues. These rise very sharply in the North Sea area, in the Dutch Republic and in England, in the early modern period. And here we see an activity index of the European Parliament from Van Zandt and Bering and Bosco. Again, the North Sea area built up to, this is the number of years per century in which the Parliament meets, starts out very low in the North Sea area, ends up being 100%, moves in the opposite direction in Mediterranean Europe. Well, you think about Asia as well, and you can see people like Eric Jones arguing Asian states held back development because they were more centralized and autocratic than European states. There's not really much evidence for this. I think it's much easier to see the problems being highlighted by Epstein and Ryan rather than those by emphasized by National Mother Johnson Robinson here. In the case of India, Martha Sobranti draws a comparison between Britain and India and says the problem is India's lack of a strong fiscal state. Recent work by Sebastian Pranger looks at piracy in the Indian Ocean. So, look, the problem here is the state's too weak. It requires merchants to create private initiatives to substitute for the lack of state security. China and India also failed to keep pace with Northwest Europe in increasing fiscal capacity. We don't have to. They always sit at the bottom. We have the fiscal capacity, per capita fiscal revenues very low and even falling away in China and still rather low in India. We also have for China, Brandt, Ma, and Rorsky showing actually the downward trend in fiscal revenue per head is all the way from the Golden Song to the collapse of the machine. Recent paper by Sun and Moriguchi compares Japan and China and the
per capita tax revenue is rising in Japan, falling in China. Our third structural difference is the quantity and quality of labour. There's an old literature on this, of course, reaching back to Max Weber, saying it's the Protestant ethic that gives Northwest Europe its edge. This has been secularised recently. Young Priest calls it the Industrious Revolution. Interestingly, he stole the term from Akira Mayami working on Japan. That's interesting because I said we'll be looking for similarities, not just differences between Japan and Britain. These are the two parts of Eurasia that have the first breakthrough to modern economic growth. So the basic idea here is that people work harder to obtain the new goods which are coming in as a result of industrial innovation and long distance trade. In Europe, we do see this reduction in number of holidays after the Reformation. Also, people seemingly unreasonably being required to turn up for work on a Monday. It used to be known as St. Monday, this is no longer tolerated. And the English data seem to be consistent with this pattern. Here's a table from Jacob's work with Bob Allen. You can see increase in the number of days worked per year. It's an approximate number. Jan de Vries finds a similar pattern in the Netherlands, which he argues is due to a slower elimination of the same days in Catholic Europe. So average days worked are lower. It's been quantified recently by Paolo Malanima for the case of Italy. He finds by comparing data on real wages and GDP per capita, you can work out the number of days worked per year. It's an average of about 182, but it does also increase during the 16th century. But it is lower than in Northwest Europe. Hayami argued that the Japanese Industrialist Revolution was underpinned by more opportunities for women working in proto industry. Interestingly, Ken Pomerantz says China also had an industrialist revolution. But I think we have to be careful here because Bitcoin has used a different term for this. He calls it involution. What's happening in China is overpopulation, leading to smaller and smaller land holdings. So just to hang on to subsistence then, women are being driven out to work in broker industry. But there's no link here to fertility through the age of first marriage females. So in the Chinese case, we're not seeing the accumulation of human capital, which is particularly emphasized by Saito in the case of Japan. Without that, you don't get development. So that's why we want to link quantity and quality of labor together as a single factor. Northwest Europe looks different because of its demographic regime. Late marriage, limited fertility. If you've got limited fertility, it's creating more human capital accumulation. Firstly, fewer children who can invest more in their education, invest in human capital. And secondly, women who do not go straight into marriage early have more job market opportunities and build up human capital in labor market. We can quantify these differences to some extent, at least. Here we can look at the average age of first marriage of females, work by Denison and Ogilvy for Northwest Europe. Relatively high age of first marriage, already by the 16th century here, 24, 25, 26, it's really quite high. It's catching up in the Mediterranean region. In the 16th century, quite a big difference. It's not really closed until the 19th century. China and India also have much lower age of marriage females. So Japan is in some sense an intermediate place here, looking closer to the Northwest European pattern than the rest of Asia. So those are the structural differences then. Now let's see how the shocks hit these economies with different structures and it leads to divergence. First shock is the Black Death, and that's really the start of the catching up process. The Black Death has different effects in different parts of Europe. Now, the simplest effect we might expect if we took a very simple Malthusian model would be you have a massive mortality shock. Within 3 years, one third of the population is wiped out. Plague keeps returning. At the end of 100 years, you're down to about half the starting population. Black Death kills people, it doesn't kill land or capital. So if you survived, you're doing very nicely. A lot more land, more capital, your income goes up. As we see a return to population growth from the mid-15th century, then we'd expect to see this going to reverse. That is what we see in Italy. It's not what we see in Britain at all. Why not? Well, here's where we have to appeal to these structural factors. There's sectoral diversification. Expansion of the livestock sector, certainly within agriculture, movements towards industry and services. But secondly, the state is strong enough to ensure an integrated market, and there is quantitative evidence on this. I've cited here later by Chiloze, Murphy, Studer, and Tunstall from explorations. And on the quantity and quality of labour, we have the Industrial Revolution and the high age of marriage of females, already there by the 16th century. Now, Black Death has a slightly different effect in Spain. There's no increase in per capita income at all. Why not? Well, the argument of Alvarez Nagar and Prados Les Guzura is that it's a frontier economy. So whereas England is sort of really very highly densely populated, you kill off a third of the population, people survive or better off. In Spain, people are kind of scattered in a not very densely settled area. This is going to reduce specialisation and division of labour because you can no longer maintain the commercial networks which are supporting loads of people. So we're going to see an increase in per capita GDP in Spain. We don't see any signs of positive Black Death effect in Asia either. Japan's not so surprising. It's an isolated society. It's cut off from the rest of Asia. The Black Death doesn't ever take hold in Japan. In China, we do see a population decline at this time, but it's also the Mongol interval. The Chinese state is overrun by nomadic peoples. This pulls down the institutional framework that was sustaining the high levels of per capita income in the Northern Tsar dynasty. So we don't see any positive effect there either. There's no, the data aren't very good for India on this, but there seems to be no sign of a major fall in population. So the Black Death then has this effect of raising per capita incomes permanently in the North Sea area and nowhere else in Europe or occasion. Then we come to 1500 and the second shock, the opening of the new trade routes. And this accelerates the process of divergence, again, I think, because of asymmetric effects. The surprising thing with the trade routes is that we might have expected it to be of more benefit to Spain and Portugal than to Britain and Holland. Why? Because the Spanish and the Portuguese were the pioneers, and they both had Atlantic coasts as well as Mediterranean coasts. But they're not the gainers. The gainers are Britain and Holland. Why do they gain? I come back to the arguments I made about the state, the institutions. They are more successful at raising tax revenue. They can then expand state capacity, creating a unified market, effectively enforce market rules. But they also dominate on executive constraints. They are successful through Parliament in stopping the state from interfering arbitrarily in business matters. What about Asia? Well, there's a big contrast between the key Asian states and the European states, whereas the European states encouraged the voyages of discovery, even funded them in some cases. The Asian states turn inwards. In China, it happens in the 15th century, following the voyages to the Western Oceans. That leaves perhaps a short period when the Japanese have an advantage, but then from the 1630s, Tokugawa Japan turns inwards as well, and adopts a similar policy. We might be a little bit skeptical about the extent to which these governments in the early modern period were able to actually close off trade. But nevertheless, just think about what the contrast is. States trying to ban foreign trade in Asia, in Europe, encouraging it, financing it, and then setting up companies to exploit it. It's very different. So that only leaves India. India is the only one that remains open to trade, but it doesn't lead to any prosperity because they've got such fragmented states, such low levels of state capacity, they can't even provide security for merchants who have to go out and provide their own security. So, I've just about reached the end on time, I hope. My usual conclusion, more research needed. I think on the first part of the talk, though, I can claim that historical national accounting has now made a substantial contribution to understanding the rate of divergence. To put in that context of the real divergences, we're taking account of the regional diversity stressed by the California school. There's still more to be done, of course. We'd like to have data from more countries. So if anybody is thinking about that, it would be nice to see more work on historical GDP for the countries, particularly Eastern Europe, I'll say it's not being much so far. We now have the first Polish estimates coming through. Secondly, we'd be interested in more regional disaggregation. I've talked about in China the importance of the Yangtze Delta region. We can also do some regional work in India. Roy has some estimates of Bengal. But we'd like more regional disaggregation for large countries. But really, where for me, the much more work needs to be done now is on the right-hand side variables. If we can accept, yes, we know when the great divergence occurred, which countries, we still need a lot more data on the variation in the variables I've been talking about as possible. Finally, I would say we need to pay more attention to Japan. I emphasize how Japan in Asia is seemingly following that same path towards small economic growth. growth, a plateau, further growth. It's avoiding growth of Brussels. It has already learned to dampen growth of Brussels by the top of the Darwin period. It does not fall back there. And that's important. Because, you know, think about the spread of long-term growth in Europe and in Asia. In Europe, it spreads fairly quickly to economies which are similar, first in northern Europe, ultimately in southern Europe. In Asia, it's a long time when it follows the Japanese lead. Understanding the way Japan built up that resilience to growth of Brussels is very important.